today is 3 days' journey into the 40 days from which Yahweh's servant Abraham was willing to offer up to the Most High his only begotten son of his wife Sarah's womb, and the day that he resurrected his only begotten son. In the last video, I spoke about the Most High's answer to his servant Abram's question when he asked him, how is it that he could know that he would possess the land? The Most High's answer to this question was a prophecy for when the great earthquake of the revelations of his only begotten son and other prophecies would come. At the end of his answer, he told his servant in Genesis chapter 15, and you, Abram, will go to your fathers in peace, and you will be buried in a good old age. And in the fourth generation, they will turn back to here again, because the fullness of the iniquity of the Amorites is still not here. This fourth generation parallels the fourth 84-day period of time that I discussed in the last video. I want to point out that I worded a detail wrong in this video. I said that there are 400 days that encompass the first day of Jeroboam's profane feast of that year and this coming 24th day of the ninth month. I should have said of this year, referring to the 15th day of the eighth month that we just passed nearly 4 months ago. This 400-day waypoint from the coming exceedingly great earthquake was the 24th day of the great and the fearful day of Yahweh. This parallels the Most High's servant Abraham being in the 24th year of his journey with him from when he obeyed his voice and he left his kindred that brought him to the day that Yahweh changed his name to Abraham and he cut the covenant of circumcision with him. But the Most High had already cut the covenant with him to give him the promised land 15 years earlier, when his servant was 84 years old. This 24th day also parallels the 24 elders that sat at the Most High's throne, of that which his servant Abraham became one of them when Yahweh resurrected his only begotten son. When this great quake begins at the end of the 24th day of the ninth month next year, the land masses of the world are going to begin to be moved back into their place to where they were before the great flood. And this restoration is not going to take very long. I read that they estimate that the eastern ocean of the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel makes up about 29% of the oceans of the world. This ocean is going to be no more when these lands that are on each side of it merge back together. This would certainly account for the 3/3 parts of the following prophecy given to us in Revelation chapter 8, and the second angel or the second messenger sounded in the manner of a great mountain burning with fire being cast into the sea, a third part of the sea became blood, and a third part of the creatures that were in the sea that and had life died, and a third part of the ships were destroyed. It could be that the Most High is going to cast a great fiery stone from the skies into this eastern sea to trigger this great quake. My understanding of these prophecies at this point is that they are separate events. However, with the Most High shortening the days, maybe they are indeed connected. One thing is for sure, and that is that the countdown to this great earthquake is ticking away quickly, even if some of the effects of these other trumpets are going to precede it. And when this giant quake occurs, there is going to be no doubt as to where the Most High's tree of life is located. But for now, you can know where this tree is located in advance of this great shaking by simply believing the testimony of His Word. In part 1, I read to you in Genesis chapter 2, verse 8, Yahweh Elohim planted a garden east of Eden, east of His delight, and He put the man that He had formed there. His word tells us that He planted a particular tree in the midst of this garden. His word calls this tree the tree of life, and He also calls it the tree of knowledge of good and evil. In doing so, He identifies what kind of tree this was. He told His creation that if we eat of this tree, that dying we will die, even if we even touch it. His word testifies that all who continue to live in rebellion to the word of His mouth will die. This is also very simple to understand if you will simply believe His word. Adam and Eve rebelled against the word of His mouth. They chose to decide right from wrong for themselves. The Most High's word tells us what is right and what is wrong in His eyes. The word of His mouth tells us what is good and what is evil in His eyes. If we rebel against that which is good and right in His eyes and do that which is wrong or evil in His eyes, we have eaten of this tree and He casts us from His garden of delight. Rebellion to the word of His mouth is evil in His eyes. Since the land of His delight is west of His garden of delight, and therefore west of this tree of life, His causing His two cherubim to dwell at the eastern entrance of this garden tells us that there is no other way into His delight except for through this entrance. And since the entrance of this garden is shut up, the only way to enter through this closed entrance is to take up the flaming sword that is at its entrance and hedge about the pathway of the tree of life that He gave to us to walk with Him on. Therefore, the only way through this entrance into His delight is through obedience to His pathway. He has sent His two witnesses to testify to the hidden pathway to the tree of life. He has sent us with the knowledge of that which is good and evil in His eyes. He showed those who became His 144,000 first fruits this hidden pathway because they chose to seek after His righteousness and His kingdom with their entire life. But now it is no longer hidden. The fruit that He forbids us to eat of or to even touch is rebelling against the word of His mouth and deciding good and evil for ourselves. His word tells us that the olive branch is symbolic of His two witnesses. There is a reason why the Mount of Olives is east of the Temple Mount. There is a reason why it was named this way. It is because of the olive trees that were once upon its slopes. There's a reason why the Garden of Gethsemane is on the western side of this mount. There is a reason why there are some very old olive trees in this garden. The Temple Mount is to the west of this garden because it is where the Most High's delight is. He delighted in His servant Abraham obeying the word of His mouth in being willing to offer up His only begotten son of His wife Sarah's womb at this location. If this is not the location of His delight, then why did He choose this location of all places upon the earth for our ancestors to build two houses unto Him? Why were there two houses? Why were they both destroyed? It is because our ancestors rebelled against the word of His mouth that He spoke to them through His servants the prophets. Why is it that He told His servant Abraham to offer up His son to Him at this location? Why is it that His only begotten Son came to the temple that stood upon this location and overturned their tables and cast them out? When He did, He said in Matthew chapter 21, verse 13, "It is written, My house is to be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." Is it a coincidence that the Most High calls you a thief because of your failure to bring Him your tithes and your offerings to the depository of His house at this time? If His only begotten Son referred to this location as His Father's house, then is this not the place that the Most High delights in? It is very important to understand why He planted the garden east of this location and why He put a particular tree in the midst of it. He did so because He knew that man would rebel against Him, and He knew that He was one day going to send His two witnesses to testify to that which is recorded in His scriptures of truth, that which causes Him to delight in us. He knew that He was going to send His first witness to us, speaking in parables, so that seeing we could see, but we would not be able to perceive, and hearing we could hear, but we would not be able to understand. But now that His temple of first fruits is finished, He has sent His second witness speaking plainly in the language that He gave to the scattered descendants of Israel to speak at this time. And that which was hidden is no longer hidden, including the location of His delight and the location of the tree that is in the midst of the garden to the east of His delight. This tree is an olive tree. This is why He calls His two witnesses branches of an olive tree. His restoration of all things is this tree. Again, the forbidden fruit is to decide to have knowledge of that which is right from wrong or good from evil for ourselves. And again, the word of his mouth tells us what is good in his eyes and what is evil in his eyes. He has sent his two witnesses to you with his knowledge of what is good in his eyes and what is evil in his eyes. The flaming sword that is at the east of this garden is the testimony of his word that he has given to his two witnesses. The revelations of his only begotten Son tell us that fire comes forth from his two witnesses' mouths. Yeshua casting them out from the location of his Father's house was a good example of fire coming forth from his mouth, and so was his calling them snakes and vipers and liars and hypocrites and such. He told them that they were children of their father Satan. There is a reason why Yahweh's word tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 2, Yahweh came unto you at Sinai, and he rose up at Seir, and he shined at Mount Paran, and he will bring many thousands of his saints and his right hand with a fiery decree to you. His second witness is crying out this decree to you ahead of his first witness and the rest of his 144,000 first fruits shining in the east and being seen in the west. There is a reason why Yahweh led his servant Solomon to build the two doors to his house from an olive tree. There is no other way into his delight other than through the testimony of his word. His first witness spoke this when he said, I am the pathway, I am the truth, I am the life, and no man can come to the Father except through the pathway of me. His Father manifested him to us in the image of his word. The revelations of Yahweh's only begotten Son tell us that he gave him his word to be his name. Therefore, when Yeshua said this, he said, the word of Elohim is the pathway. The word of Elohim is the truth. And the word of Elohim is life, referring to entering in through the gate of his word into eternal life. No man can come to the Father except through the pathway of his word. Again, he has sent his two witnesses to testify to the pathway of his word. This is why Yeshua referred to himself as the gate of the sheepfold. And this is why Yahweh's word also testifies that the same is true of his second witness. If you think that you can figure this out on your own at this point in time, you are denying the testimony of his word that tells us that he is going to tell us what is recorded in his scriptures of truth through his one servant at this time. There is a reason why he calls the tent of his appointed times his dwelling place. These things are not complicated, nor are they being hidden from you at this time. There is a reason why his word tells us in Zechariah 14:4, in that day his dual feet will stand upon the Mount of Olives that is before the face of Jerusalem upon the east, and the Mount of Olives will rent in half from the sunrise to the sea, referring to from the east to the west. And there will be a very great valley, and half of the mountain will move to the north and half of it to the south. Why isn't the face of Jerusalem some other direction? Is it a coincidence that the garden and the tree of life were to the east of Eden or to the east of delight? If you do not believe that he tells us dual feet in this verse, then go buy a concordance that has Hebrew grammar notations in it and look for yourself. From the east to the west is one of several parallels to as lightning comes from the east and is seen in the west. The lightning is the shimmering sword of Yahweh's word. It is the light of his word, and it is the judgment of his word. When Abram asked Yahweh how he could know, and he told him to offer up to him the three tiers of three and the fledgling of the dove, we are told in Genesis chapter 15, verse 17, and while the sun was still gone, and it was twilight, he beheld a smoking oven and a fiery lamp that passed over between these pieces. The twilight in this prophecy parallels it to his Ezekiel chapter 12 Son of Man prophecy that is for you to do as I have done and dig out from the captivity. This prophecy even tells us the timing of my flight when the Most High caused me to hide my face from this land. It was in the twilight. The smoking oven parallels the following prophecy. Malachi, or my messenger, chapter 4, verse 1. Because behold, the day comes when all of the proud will burn in an oven, Yes, and all who do wickedly will be stubble, and the day that comes will burn them up, so that I will leave them neither root nor branch, says Yahweh of hosts. This prophecy goes on to tell us that one was going to be sent to us in a similitude of his servant Elijah to tell us to mark his Torah with his statutes and his judgments that he gave to us at Horeb through his servant that he drew out from the water before the great and the fearful day of his wrath. This oven is smoking hot at this time. The fiery lamp that the Most High has sent me with is the light of his word, his sword. Yahweh showed his servant Abram this oven and this lamp passing through the pieces of these three tiers of three for a reason. There is a reason why his word tells us that these nine sacrifices were chopped up into pieces. There is a reason why his word tells us that the fledgling of the dove was not chopped up. The second dove brought back the olive branch, just like the Most High has sent his second witness to you to be a fiery lamp unto you to show you his pathway. This is the way. Walk in it or prepare to die. In part 1, I read to you in Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 1, and I turned back to the door of his house, and I beheld the waters going or flowing out from under the threshold of the house eastward, because the face of the house was to the east, and the waters descended from under the right side of the house, and it flowed south of the altar. This prophecy goes on to tell us that his end-time Son of Man then measured this river from this entrance. The flow of this living water was divided into four tiers, each 1,000 cubits long, and each segment of water got deeper as it went. These four measurements also represent the four tiers of 84 days. In the fourth measurement, the water was so deep that it could not be passed over. This is symbolic of the fourth period of 84 days being the last of them that you are not going to be able to cross over. This prophecy goes on to tell us, to start in verse 6, and he said to me, Son of man, what do you see? Then he carried me and turned me back to the bank of the river. The bank of the river parallels the Son of Man to the Michael of his Daniel chapter 12 prophecy, the one who would be sent to you clothed in linen. And when I turned back, I beheld upon the bank of the river, there were very many trees on this side and on the other. These are olive trees because with the renewed covenant, the Most High is going to put his Torah in your inward parts and write it upon your hearts, and you are not going to need to be taught good from evil any longer. Then he said to me, these waters go out towards the east border, referring to the living waters that flow out from his temple, from his house, and go down upon the desert, referring to the land that is east of the Mount of Olives toward the Dead Sea, and go into the sea, and come to the sea to heal the waters. And it will be that all living creatures that live and abound upon all that the dual rivers come upon will live. And there will be a very great abundance of fish because these waters will come there and they will be healed and all that come there to the river will live. The way that this ties in with the Most High turning the baptism waters into blood and why the Dead Sea is dead at this time is discussed in other videos. Why does this verse say the dual rivers? Could it be because they flow out through Yahweh's two witnesses, like his seven spirits flow out upon and through his two witnesses, his two olive branches? There are many, many other details that he gave to us in the testimony of his word that testify to this as well. If you want to enter into his delight, there is only one way for you to do so. And this is through vomiting out the bread of men that you have become satisfied with and taking up the flaming sword that he has sent his two witnesses with and hedging about his pathway to his tree of life that has been restored. And if you refuse to obey that which the word of his mouth has spoken through his second anointed son, your doing so will testify against you that you still want to continue to eat the forbidden fruit, deciding right from wrong for yourselves, telling the Most High how it is, according to your own stubborn, rebellious, uncircumcised hearts. And dying you will die. Thus saith Yahweh's word that is upon his servant Zerubbabel's mouth.